merciful, have mercy on the one who has fallen. As Adam saw the angel pushing and shutting the door of God's garden, he groaned aloud and said, O merciful, have mercy on the one who has fallen. Sharing the pain, O paradise, of your beggared master, and with the sound of your leaves implore the Creator not to shut you. O merciful, have mercy on the one who has fallen. Paradise, all virtue, all holiness, all happiness, planted because of Adam, shut because of Eve, how shall I lament for you? O merciful, have mercy on the one who has fallen. How have I fallen? Where have I arrived? From a pedestal to the ground, from a divine admonition to a wretched existence, have I been reduced? O merciful, have mercy on the one who has fallen. God himself pity me, clothes my nakedness. By this he shows me that he too cares for me, the transgressor. O merciful, have mercy on the one who has fallen. The clothing signifies for me the state that is to come, for the one who has now clothed me in a little while wears me and saves me. O merciful, have mercy on the one who has fallen. Rouse my mind to praise, raise up the one who lies sick in bed, who unworthily Savior cries to you. O merciful, have mercy on the one who has fallen. Raise up, make firm, O lover of mankind, the one who has now stumbled as a profligate in life. Draw near me, Savior, as I cry. O merciful, have mercy on the one who has fallen. Reverend Father Constantine, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, the verses of the remarkable poem by St. Romanus the Melodist, crafted in the 5th century, collectively termed Adam's Lament, portray the fall of man from paradise, the rupture of man's eternal essence from the trust and love of his Creator, and his fall into an existential state of despair. Yet, even in man's fall from paradise, his Creator remains close to him, offering to one day, when man chooses to return, to clothe him and to raise him up, to return him to his initial state, an icon and in likeness to his Creator. This poem is not only a historical account of man's fall from paradise, but an account of every person's journey in life, a journey that is full of spiritual challenges, of lifting up and carrying heavy crosses, and much lamentation. Yet it is a journey that offers many opportunities for humankind to change course and to follow a path of light away from the darkness of human spiritual weakness and spiritual death. 8 weeks ago today, in the waning afterglow of the setting sun, and without any particular celebration or fanfare, the Triodion opened. The word Triodion refers to a cycle in the ecclesiastic year of the Orthodox Church, as well as a collection in the form of a book of the hymns and the services that comprise the cycle. It is also known as Triodion, the Devout, and it is so inscribed on the very first page. The ecclesiastic period and the book that is used opens on the dusk of the Saturday 4 weeks before Lent. It begins with poetry, hymns, that call the faithful to enter into a period of earnest introspection, self-correction, and service to one another. It covers the entire period of Lent and Holy Week, and it ends just a few moments before the service of the resurrection on Easter Sunday. Many of the hymns can be traced back to as early as the 5th century to their creators, who were eminent poets and fathers of the Christian Church, with a golden age between the 8th to the 11th century. In no other ecclesiastic period can one distinguish the words repentance, tears, humility, prayer, fasting, cleansing, so often in a given service, as those of the Theodore. Humility, repentance, and tears held great cleansing power in the eyes of the early church and in the writings of the church fathers and ascetics. Within minutes of the first service of the Triodion period, the Vespers of the Sunday of the Publican and the Pharisee, and upon the first few words of the very first hymn, the concepts of humility, prayer, and fasting are introduced. Brethren, let us not pray like the Pharisee, for those who exalt themselves will be humbled, Let us be humbled before God through fasting like the tax collector as we cry aloud, God, forgive us, sinners. Another hymn, the first which says to God in the same service, also tells us about tears and their spiritual value. Almighty Lord, I know how powerful tears are. They brought Ezekiah up from the gates of death. They delivered a sinful woman from the transgressions of many years. They justified the tax collector above the Pharisee. And so I pray, numbering me with them, have mercy on me. Finally, in the matin service of the Sunday of the Publican and the Pharisee, and every Sunday thereafter until Palm Sunday, humility and repentance are again emphasized. O giver of life, open to me the doors of repentance, for my spirit enters your holy temple early in the morning, bearing a defiled temple of the body. But as you are compassionate, cleanse it by the loving kindness of your mercy. And the sequence ends with, as I realize the multitude of the dreadful things I have done, and the wretch that I am, I tremble for the fearful day of judgment. But trusting in the mercy of your compassion, I cry out to you as did the King David, have mercy on me, O Lord, according to your great mercy.
Is on earth as it is in heaven.
Ambrosian and Gregorian chant. Byzantine chant is the oldest musical expression of ecclesiastic poetry of the Christian Church. Unlike Ambrosian and Gregorian chant, the music of the Eastern Church from the 5th century onward was adapted to the meter and rhythm of the poetry that it was designed to subserve. Byzantine chant emphasized the tonicity of words and developed innovative melodic devices to stress the accented syllables of words, and it sustained a meter and a rhythm. Like Ambrosian and Gregorian chant, the music is modal. In contrast, unlike the former, Byzantine chant expanded past the limitations of the four original modes and incorporated many elements of ancient Hellenic musical modal structure, borrowing heavily from Greek prosody and Greek drama. From the 5th century onward, the number of hymns expanded exponentially, motivated to a large degree by ascetics in monasteries in Jerusalem, Alexandria, Damascus, Antioch, and the Sinai. Most of the hymnography that the Orthodox Church uses during the Triodium period can be traced back to the monastery of St. Sabas in Jerusalem and to the prolific hymnographers John of Damascus, Cosmas the Melodist, and Andrew of Crete. Not to be outdone, the ascetics in the monastery of Studium in Constantinople, who had adapted the tipikon of the monastery of St. Sabas, were the Orthodox. They provided hymns equal in depth in poetry, literary, and theologic content to those of the Sabaite school. Theodore, the abbot of Studium in Constantinople, Theophanes the inscribe, and many other Studite monks have all contributed to the rich hymnographic content of the Triodium. With the increasing complexity of poetic meter and length of the hymns, memorizing the melodies became a challenge. Thus, John of Damascus adapted a form of writing into the first form of musical notation, which in fact was stenographic. The symbols represented musical cadences and formulae underneath which the syllables of the hymn were placed. This constituted the first phase of notation of Christian ecclesiastic poetry. Three other periods of notation evolution would follow in the 9th, the 12th, and the 17th century, all based on evolutions of stenographic representations of even more formulae and cadences, entire musical phrases practically, with a huge number, a large length, and significant complexity. By the 17th century, the system became unwieldy. It took between 20 to 30 years of intense study and memorization alongside a master for someone to learn to serve as a chanter in the Eastern Church. This, of course, on top of the demands for vocal talent. By the late 17th century, the Patriarchate of Constantinople realized that this problem required a solution that would permit someone to learn, to the most faithful degree possible, all the hymnology and the music of the church in order to serve it. The breakthrough came in the persons of Gregorios Orthodoxalis, the chief chanter of the Patriarchal Church, a person deeply knowledgeable of the stenographic systems of the 16th and the 17th century, as well as Kurmusios Takartophylax, who began a reformation of the stenographic system into a linear, Western-like method. As Gregorios and Kurmusios worked on the exegesis, or the translation of the old stenography into a linear system of symbols, Chrysanthos, who would become Bishop of Malida, was concurrently working on the reformation of the theoretical aspects of the modal system of ecclesiastic music, so that somebody who had no idea could learn in a very quick time. In 1814, they came together and proposed the new method, a cohesive theoretical and practical approach to performance that astounded even the old masters of Byzantine chant. The authenticity to the established traditions was remarkable. Thus, as soon as the new method was submitted to the ecclesiastic committees of the Ecumenical Patriarchate in Constantinople, it was immediately adopted as the method that would be used to teach and to interpret the hymnology of the Orthodox Christian Church. What before took 30 years to learn and master, now would take less than 5. Today, this is the method that is still in use in all traditional Orthodox churches in the world, and it has been successfully implemented in the past 10 years to interpret even translations in English, French, Spanish, Italian, Swahili, Korean, Japanese, and Chinese. A young man, destitute, with dirty, ragged, and torn clothes, standing at the edge of an insect-infested pond, tending two pigs, with eyes red from tears and with a body condition that betrays years of punishment and hunger. A father, in a fabulous home with considerable wealth and with endless supplies of food and an army of servants. A father well into his old age, whose eyes are equally red from tears, who laments from dusk to dawn the estrangement of his son. But the father does not lose hope. He waits. Every morning and early evening, he walks up to the highest rampart of the castle and stares far and carefully into the distance. He is convinced that his son will return. Despite the strong burning sun and the painful thorns of rain that rip into him daily as he stands unprotected in his unending vigil, he knows my son will return. And there, one day, suddenly the tear-filled eyes of the old father discern a small dark speck which has come into focus on the horizon. He leaps up and cries, "My child! My child is coming." Rapidly, breathlessly, he navigates his descent on the staircase, 2x2, 3x3, carelessly too, as some of his servants privately snicker at the old man's apparent loss of all reason. Reaching the ground level, the old man fumbles with a jamb of the front door, and finding it, he flings it wide open. He lunges into the field, and he runs, shouting with joy. He stumbles over the rocks. He falls. He picks himself up and continues running to the individual who from a distance is coming ever so closer. And in a single moment in time, the two parallel, concurrent, and side-by-side scenes that could have been scripted by Hollywood converge and meld into one glorious and radiant moment. The two protagonists become one. With outstretched arms, the old man careens into his son and hugs him unlike at any other time in his life. The son, tired, falls into his father's arms and pulls him to the ground. Then painfully, he sits on his knees and in an exhausted, weak voice, he pleads, "Father, forgive me, for I am unworthy," but he is unable to complete the remainder of the sentence. "My son," cries the father, and embraces and kisses him like never before. The scene, as moving as it may be, is also majestic. It is precise and beautiful. It is a spiritual earthquake that shapes the didactic parable of the prodigal son. Many church fathers have stated that even if the entire gospel were lost, and only this parable remained as scripture, it would be more than enough to demonstrate the love of God for his creation. Man, and the central tenet of Christianity, unconditional love and unconditional forgiveness. Three hymns distinguish the second Sunday of the Theodorean period and all serve as a script for the protagonist, who is none other than the prodigal son. The first, in the Vesper services of this Sunday, is also rich when considered from a philologic and literary perspective. It likens the life of the prodigal son to that of a seed sower who reaps a harvest appropriate to his choices in life. God entrusted me to be in a land blessed and plentiful of life, paradise, and in it I sowed and planted sin. With a sickle I reaped the wheat of negligence, and with my palms I piled them on stacks of my evil deeds, instead of orderly paving them onto the threshing floor of repentance. Note the specificity of the language used to distinguish among acts of evil and acts of repentance, as they are depicted as a careless stacking of a harvest. earnest and an act of careful and thoughtful behaving respectfully. The hymn continues. But I beseech you, God, the pre-eternal farmer and husbandman, sort the few good works of mine from the straws of sin with the wind of your mercy, nourish my soul with repentance, seal me inside your heavenly repository, and save me. The hymn additionally describes an agricultural cycle and likens it to a circle of spiritual life, from seed to fruit, from life to death to the resurrection, and to eternal life through repentance and salvation. The last of the three key hymns of the Sunday of the Prodigal Son in the Matin service again depicts the drama of the prodigal son. However, his misfortune becomes a personal issue of the hymnographer. This hymn is a confession of man, the sinner, to God the Father, a confession that indicates the recognition of mistakes and shows that he wants to come back to the warmth of the paternal abode, much like the lost lamb returning to the flock. Man the sinner, in full confession and in full repentance. At the same time, the opening words of this hymn, can be translated in two ways. One, in a literal fashion, and in a way that more faithfully reflects the prodigal soul of the son. Literally, the interpretation is, good and kind father. But the son knew that his father was good. He knew that his father was kind. Why would he choose to address him in a way that describes the self-evident? Did the father not give him his due years ago when he had asked for it and squandered it? Instead, the translation that is probably more theologically appropriate would be benign father, which in the context of the manner in which the son addresses the father initially, would actually be an insult and an accusation. Reflected in this interpretation is the weak nature of the prodigal son and of humankind who, even though running to a good and kind father in the face of despair, accuse and mock him in a manner not too unlike, if you really are a good and kind father, why have you let these bad things happen to me? How many times in our lives, in the face of despair, have we not accused God of letting bad things happen to us? In return, the Father not only welcomes the Son with open arms, but offers to him the most exquisite repast, which symbolizes nothing else but Holy Communion, the blood and the body of the sacrificed Son of God. Among all the known composers of the hymn, only Nicholas Georgiou, Protopsalpis of Smyrna, who lived in the late 18th century, understood this nuance of the theology and appropriately interpreted musically a beginning of the hymn that reminds one of an accusation, a stab, an insult. The melody then quickly crumbles into a repentant realization that the Father is not only benign, but he is good, and he is kind. Father, I have estranged myself from you. Do not forsake me, and do not mark me as unworthy of your kingdom. The most evil enemy has stripped me bare and has taken my wealth. I have squandered the gifts of my soul in sinful living. I have raised myself now, and I return to you, and I cry aloud, take me as one of your hired servants. I am unworthy to be your son, but you stretched out your pure arms on the cross for my sake, so that you might snatch me from the dreadful beast and clothe me as I was first adorned, for you alone are merciful. The musical mode is called playful second in Byzantine chant. It is appropriate to convey the remorse of the prodigal son and his acceptance that his father has already welcomed him unconditionally, in spite of the son stabbing at it, accusing him. Mr. Theodore Meris Kakoulides, your chanter, the son of the late legendary Philoptochos Nikolaos Kakoulides, who was one of the most renowned chanters of Greece of the last century, will interpret the hymn using the composition of Nicholas of Smyrna. Note the beginning musical cadence that stabs accusingly in an insult, and how then the melody will evolve into the Father is unconditional love and unconditional acceptance.
Peace.
The Church calls upon the faithful to enter the stadium of virtuous earnest in the setting of the first of five devout grand Sunday Vespers. The hymnography of each of these Sunday evenings is astounding, and the music is unsurpassed, especially the music associated with the grand Orchestica, first composed in the 14th century and later perfected by Iakovos Protopsaltis in the 18th. Those that are fortunate to participate in such services with appropriate and well-trained musical ensembles or chanters are quick to point to the mystagogical environment of the darkly lit church with a spectrum of dusk colors filtering inside as the day ends. The dusk light that lands upon it modulates the tones and colors of the icons or of the stained glass to give them a heavenly and a supernatural life. Indeed, this is the ideal environment in which one can chant, "O gladsome light, Fossi Laron." And immediately after this, the atmosphere deepens even darker as the day ends. A lone voice, a single chanter begins the slow, ancient melody of the great Prokimenon. The souls of the faithful open and cry as the melody serves the Logos, the Word. Do not turn your face away from me, from your servant. Answer me quickly, for I am in trouble. Come near me and save me. But the Vesper service will not end without an offer of hope. The hope is who else? Panagia, the Virgin of Theodokos, the Mother of God. The tempo of the sequence of hymns that end with the prayer to the Theodokos pick up. The supplication to the Theodokos is part of a sequence that invokes John the Baptist, the Holy Apostles, all characters in an act whose aim is to stand by the faithful in support of the Lenten battle against evil and sin. It is your mercy and grace that we escape to Mother of God. Do not overlook or ignore our request for support and salvation, but protect and save us from danger, for only you are pure and blessed. During the first week of Lent, many Orthodox Christians do not even eat or drink anything for 3 days until Wednesday evening, where they receive Holy Communion at the first Lenten liturgy of the pre-sanctified gifts. On every day, with the exception of Wednesdays and Fridays during Lent, at the service of the Great Compline, the Church Fathers established the following hymn. O Lord of hosts, be with us, for we have no other help in times of sorrow but you. O Lord of hosts, have mercy on us. This hymn is ancient. The tone and the mode in which it is commonly chanted today is not representative of the mode in which it was chanted in old times. Therefore, in a few seconds, do not be perplexed when you hear it performed slightly differently than what you might be used to in the original plagal setting. Also, during the liturgy of the pre-sanctified gifts, the following verse from Psalm 140 of David was adopted. Let my prayer be set forth in thy sight as incense, and let the lifting up of hands be an evening sacrifice. The mode in which it is usually chanted is either first or plagal second. However, tonight we will perform this solemn hymn in a unique variation of fourth mode, which is called Iakat. It is a prayer, but it is also a prelude to celebration.
Amen.
In her attempt to keep her children steadfast at this difficult time of fasting, the Orthodox Church mobilizes events and figures to come to the aid of the faithful. The first Sunday of Lent, Sunday of Orthodoxy, reminds the faithful of the Church's glory, splendor, and grandeur. The third Sunday, Sunday of the Adoration of the Cross, presents to us the crucified Christ as if to say, look at him who was crucified for us. How difficult is your endeavor of fasting compared to what he, Christ, had to endure? On the second Sunday of Lent, the faithful are specifically exposed to the figure of Saint Gregory Palamas, the great Archbishop of Thessaloniki, and his remarkable theology that shaped the thought of the Church Fathers for centuries. On the fourth Sunday of Lent, the faithful are exposed to Saint John, who wrote the Climax, a compendium of teachings concerning repentance, asceticism, and the way to spiritual fullness, as well as a prelude to the way of monasticism. And finally, on the fifth Sunday, today, the Church commemorates Mary of Egypt, whose life and choice to leave her sinful ways and go into the desert are aimed at awakening even the most hardened sinners and to lead them into repentance. At each of the Sunday devout Grand Vespers, the cycle of eight modes will affect which hymns will be chanted. Among those that stab the soul directly are the devout Proparia of mode Plato First. In the first two Proparia, the protagonist knows that he is ill, and he accepts that he is stubborn in refusing the cure to his ills, realizing that his refusal will condemn him to a certain death. The third hymn brings back the analogy of God the Father as a farmer and husbandman, and the reference to the prodigal son as one with a parched soul yearning for acceptance. Lord, I do not cease from sinning. I do not know how to be found worthy of your love for humankind. You who alone are good, conquer the stubbornness of my heart and have mercy on me. The second, Lord, I tremble with fear and I do not cease to do evil. Who does not tremble at the judge in the courtroom? Or who, when they want to be cured, enrages the physician as I do? Long-suffering Lord, have compassion on my weakness and have mercy on me. The third proviso. Alas, why have I been likened to the barren fig tree and quail at the curse with the felling? But Christ God, heavenly husbandman, make my parched soul fruitful, and like the prodigal son, accept me and have mercy on me. Concerning mode Plato First, John of Damascus describes it as follows. Mournful you are and greatly pitying, but for the most part rhythmically you dance. O mind which art with music has informed, which is the bent oblique of Plato tones, rank holds you fifth, but first of the unique, and calls you so, O Plato of the First.
Here.
poem in all of the services of the Orthodox Church and is associated with Great Lent, since the only times it is appointed to be chanted in church are the first four nights of Great Lent, at Great Compline, when it is serialized, and at the Matins of Thursday of the fifth week of Great Lent, just this past Thursday, when it is chanted in its entirety. In this latter service, the entire life of Saint Mary of Egypt is also read. There is no other sacred hymn which compares with this monumental work, which Andrew wrote for his own personal meditation. Nothing else has its extensive typology and mystical explanations of the scripture from both the Old and the New Testaments. One can almost consider this hymn to be a survey of the Old and the New Testament. Its other distinguishing features are a spirit of mournful humility, hope in God, and complex and beautiful Trinitarian doxologies and hymns to the Theodokos in each of its many odes. The Great Canon is also a soliloquy. Its ongoing theme is an urgent exhortation to change one's life. Andrew always mentions his own sinfulness, placed in juxtaposition to God's mercy, and uses literally hundreds of references to examples of good and bad from the Old and the New Testament to convince himself to repent. The hymnist begins his soliloquy by asking, "Where shall I begin to lament the deeds of my wretched life?" A monk recounts, when he first went to Mount Athos in Greece to become a monk, he did not know which of the 20 monasteries he should join. Fortuitously, he was there during the Thursday of the Great Canon. When he entered a particular monastery, the chanter, a monk himself, began chanting the Great Canon. The chanter monk's eyes watered while beginning the first hymn of the first ode. "Where shall I begin to lament the deeds of my wretched life? What first fruit shall I offer, O Christ, for my present lamentation? But in your compassion, grant me release from my fails." Reaching the sixth and sequence hymn, desperately now trying to hold back his tears, the chanter monk broke down as he chanted, "Superessential Trinity, adorned in unity, take from me the heavy yoke of sin, and in thy compassion grant me tears of compunction." He was unable to continue. The tears flowed freely from his eyes, and his voice quavered under his crying. At a later time, the candidate monk learned that the chanter monk in his youth had killed someone in self-defense and had been exonerated by a civil jury. He nevertheless regretted his action to that very day. A monk sees everyone as a human being, and to him, to take a life, no matter how justified it could be in the face of the law, is murder. At the end of the sixth ode, one finds a conductio composed by the Romanos Melodist, considered by many to be the Pindar of Christian ecclesiastic poetry. Romanos, in this hymn, commands his soul, my soul, arise. How long will you continue to sleep? Your end is drawing near, and you are about to be disturbed. Awaken, therefore, so that Christ can have compassion on you, for God is present everywhere and fills everything."
Thank you.
From the fourth Sunday of Lent and onwards, the days pass rapidly, and time shrinks considerably as the Church gravitates towards the drama that will unfold during Holy Week. Today, the Orthodox Church celebrates the memory of Mary of Egypt, where the highly didactic doxastikon was chanted early in the morning in the Mass. The kingdom of God is not about food or drink, or put another way, with worldly riches and pleasures. One cannot enter the kingdom of God, but only through a just living, asceticism, and holiness. Thus, the cold-hearted greedy will not enter into it, but only those who place their treasure not in banks, but, what do you think, in the palms and the hands of the poor. That is the place to invest the riches. A just and respectful man is he who does good works all day long, and the Lord will grant to him, instead of the earthly, the heavenly.
Oh, yeah.
It is not clear whether the celebration of the raising of Lazarus this coming Saturday represents the transition point connecting the Lenten period and Holy Week. However, the events that are portrayed in the Gospel reading of the day highlight the eternal spiritual struggle faced by and facing mankind in a very touching scene that plays out at the abode of Lazarus. An angelic profile kneels in front of the precious feet of the teacher, Mary. The curls of her hair undone, her eyes inset, her trembling breast visibly emotional, consequent to ceaseless jubilant sobbing, not a word on her lips. Her only motion is to bring her arms in front and join the palms of her hands together in supplication. Mary offers her gratitude to him who resurrected her brother, her beloved Lazarus. And she offers her whole gratitude with all her being. In contrast, recessed in the dark depth of the room stands a glum profile, unmoved by what transpired earlier in the day when Lazarus was raised from the dead, or what is transpiring in front of him now. Passions are stirring inside his soul. And suddenly, an awful gurgling bursts from his throat and wrathfully scourges the glowing, youthful maiden, whose tear-weary eyes are glued on the feet of the teacher. Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor? In the recess behind Mary stands Judas. Behind the pure sacrificial offering of myrrh, perfume, stands ambivalent, seeking silver. The scenes that collided inside the humble abode of Lazarus in Bethany stretched out and grew and embraced the entire world. Where else but around the conflict of these two worlds, the world of spirituality and the world of materialism, is not the history of the world and mankind weaved? Indeed, inside the same conflict is weaved every person's drama, the drama that these two worlds highlight, of Judas and of Mary, who live and struggle inside of every one of us. The loving devotion displayed at the feet of Christ and the thirsty adherence to mammon. Both scenes featuring the two gladiators in a fight on harsh terrain, imprinted with the images of these two opposite persons, of the traitor and of the murderer. These images are placed by the Orthodox Church as a gate of entry into Holy Week. Not too unlike the Platonic, let no one untrained in geometry enter, they show the spiritual supplies that are required in order to enter the devout passion. Reverend Father Constantine, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, in older days and in a time bygone, the skeets, the caves, the foxholes in the desert and in the mountains were full of monks and ascetics from the start of the Great Lent, who left their monasteries to pray and to fast in the deepest parts of the wilderness. There they subjected themselves to a strict fast with prayer and little sleep. And on the Saturday of Lazarus, the day before Palm Sunday, the last day of Lent, one by one they returned to the monasteries, and they joyfully embraced their other returning brothers. With happiness and elation, they kissed each other, thanking the Lord that they, for another year, lived to return as victorious gladiators who fought bravely and justly inside the stadium of virtues in the wilderness. The Church welcomes them all, and as it celebrates the great feast of Palm Sunday, the very first hymn of the Vesper service that one hears is not one dedicated to the event, to Palm Sunday, or to Christ, or even to any other personage of Scripture, but a hymn that is dedicated wholly to the joyous return of the brothers. Today, the grace of the Holy Spirit has gathered us together, and taking up the cross, we all say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And in fact, this hymn is encountered not only once, but five times during Vespers, and then once again on Palm Sunday Matins, perhaps for those monks that returned late. When I was very young, I was not able to comprehend the need to repeat the same hymn six times in a particular service. Only much later, when I discovered the reason, did I marvel at the love of the Church and its traditions bestow upon her faithful. Reverend Father Constantine, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to conclude tonight's lecture with the wise words of St. Paul the Apostle, written almost two millennia ago in his first epistle to the Thessalonians. Be joyful always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not put out the Spirit's fire. Do not treat prophecies with contempt. Test everything. Hold on to the good. Avoid every kind of evil. The choir and I, wishing all Orthodox faithful a blessed and spiritual remainder of Lent, and a happy Easter, and more importantly, thanking everyone who today sacrificed their afternoon and early evening to come to this lecture concert, especially Father Valantasis, the parish council, the Philoptochos of St. Demetrios, who welcomed us. We thank the Lord who gives us such opportunities of spiritual embrace, and the Holy Spirit, whose grace today gathers us together.
Dostoevsky, steeped in the Orthodox Christian faith, as the protagonist of his novel, The Idiot, the prince Lev Nikolaevich Mishkin, saying the following, beauty will save the world. You've encountered tonight words, expressions, phrases, images, that as best as we humanly can convey that beauty. Is that beauty is the beauty of God. And the beauty of God is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The music that you heard, hopefully on the deepest part of your soul, brought you into contact with that divine beauty. And my dearest Dr. Nicholas and esteemed members of the Greek Orthodox, Metropolis, the Byzantine choir, your voices communicated that music beautifully. Tonight you gave us a glimpse of that beauty that will save the world. And we thank you. And beloved, don't leave. We're inviting all of you downstairs in the church hall. We have refreshments. Please come so that we can offer you hospitality as is appropriate. Again, thank you. Thank all of you. God bless you. To those of you who are not of the Orthodox faith and you come tonight, these hymns belong to all of us. Because again, they were written, prayed over at a time when there were no divisions. This is part of your spiritual inheritance as well. And we thank you for coming. God bless you. Hope to see you downstairs.